My name is Heinrich Traphöhner, and I would like to welcome you to my today's talk on the estimation and prevention of strain localization in shear tests. I will start with a motivation on the topic. Several shear tests are used for the characterization of flow curves at high strains or the fracture strain under simple shear stress state. Shear tests achieve high equivalent strains since there is no plastic instability such as necking. My today's talk focuses on the illustrated shear tests. These are the classical shear test, for example the ACM shear test, where the load is applied using conventional tensile testing machines, and the in-plane torsion test, where a round specimen is clamped in the center and in the outer ring, and a torque is applied which leads to ideal simple shear deformation. The last specimen is the in-plane torsion test with circumferential groove, which is investigated in detail in the conference proceedings, but basically not in my today's talk. The evaluation of all shear tests is nearly the same. For all shear tests, the shear stress is calculated from the measured force F, or torque M, and the local cross-section A in the shear area, which depends on the local position on the specimen. The local strain is often measured using digital image correlation systems, or short DIC, but using DIC systems, the exact measurement of shear strain is a challenge, as I will show you in the following. To visualize the issue during DIC measurement, we performed shear tests with the illustrated specimens for different materials. Shear length is 4 mm and the radius is 1 mm. The investigated materials are the ductile and strongly hardening deep drawing steel DC04 and the high strength weakly hardening complex face steel CP1000. When the load is applied, the maximum stress and strain will be induced to the area of smallest cross-section. With greater cross-section, stress and strain decreases. As you see on the right-hand side, there are material-specific differences in the strain field between DC04 and CP1000. The deformation localizes in a very narrow area. The CP1000, which has weaker hardening, shows a very narrow localization of strain. Challenging is the measurement of these very local strains, since DIC systems use discrete elements of a defined size and local stress within the discrete element will be averaged. Depending on the strain gauge length L0, which is the size of these elements, the discrete approximation is more or less accurate. To show the influence, we increased the gauge length from initially 0.15 mm to values up to 0.5 mm. For the weakly localizing DC04, only small deviations of the measured strains can be seen. But for the strongly localizing CP1000, the measured strains is up to 16% smaller for the larger gauge length. The same investigation is done with the in-plane torsion test. The strains of the in-plane torsion specimens are evaluated at a distance of 0.5 mm from the inner clamping, since strains directly at the inner clamping cannot be measured. We see on the right side the same material behavior than in the shear tests. The DC04 has a wide deformation zone, while the CP1000 locates in a narrow range. For the CP1000 steel, the measured strains with 0.5 mm gauge length is 12% higher than for the smaller gauge length. DC04 shows moderate differences of 0.5%. By the way, in the in-plane torsion test, we measure two high strains with increased strain gauge length, while we measure two small strains in the shear test shown before. So we see the problem. Different specimens, different materials, and different strain gauge lengths will lead to different errors due to the discretization of the local strains. An analytical estimation of the expected error, the discretization error, would be very helpful for the understanding of these influences. In the following, the discretization error zeta is defined as the ratio of the difference between the discrete measured strain, which depends on the strain gauge length L0, and the exact local strain gamma to the local strain gamma. The exact local strain gamma is calculated from the shear angle eta from the slope of the deformed line. The discrete strain Gamma this uses the linearized form of the equation for the area of the length L0. The displacement delta y is the integral of the local displacement dy along the area of L0, which equals the integral over gamma. Bringing both equations together, the discrete strain gamma this is the integral of the local shear strain gamma along L0 divided by L0. For the in-plane torsion test, the equations look similar. The local slope of the radial line is r d alpha divided by dr, where alpha is the rotation angle. And the discrete strain for an element of size L0 is calculated by the given integral over the length L0 divided by L0. Gamma from x and from r can be easily calculated from the specimen geometry and from the stress-strain relation, which is defined in the following. We made a few assumptions and chose proper but simple material models to handle our analytical model. The first assumption is that there is ideal simple shear in the test area with no change of the cross-section A. The second assumption is that there are no edge effects or inhomogeneity, so shear stress and shear strain are constant along the shear plane, as you see in this area. The third assumption is that the shear stress can be calculated from the torque and the force and the local cross-section, as we already saw in the first slides. Then we use the isotropic von Mises yield criterion, meaning that the equivalent strain is calculated by the plastic shear strain gamma divided by the square root of 3, and the flow stress is calculated by the square root of 3 multiplied with the shear stress tau. Last of all, we use linear elasticity and we need to know the hardening, which can be described analytically. For example, we can use the Hockey-Cherby hardening law, as you see here. Bringing all these equations together, we can calculate the local stresses and strains on the specimen. I will show you some exemplary results using the specimen shapes and materials from the experiments before. You see the approximation of the flow curves according to Hockett and Cherby in red. And these diagrams show the discretization error over the equivalent strain for different strain gauge lengths L0. Analog to the experiment, the in-plane torsion test is analytically evaluated at a radius of 15.5 mm. As you see, for the in-plane torsion test, positive errors are calculated, which means that the measured discrete strain is higher than the correct local strain, as we also saw in the experiments. The larger the strain gauge length, the higher the error. In addition, our analytical model estimates the larger deviation for CP1000 that we also saw in the experimental results. For the shear test, we see the negative error, meaning that the discrete strains are lower than the exact ones. The analytical estimation for CP1000 again shows larger discretization error. These exemplary analyses confirm the experimental results. In addition, we can conclude that the measurement deviation depends on the material behavior, the strain gauge length, and the specimen shape, and the analytical model is capable to estimate these deviations. Now we can estimate the error, but how can we prevent the error? We identified four approaches during our work. First of all, we can reduce the strain gauge length to a proper value. Secondly, we can modify the specimen design to reduce local strain gradients. The third strategy is to calculate the error and analytically compensate the measured strain iteratively. And the last strategy is to use other measurement methods, for example, evaluate the force displacement curve. In this work, we focused on the first two strategies. We will reduce the gauge length and we will present a modified specimen shape. For the first strategy, the leading question is, how much do we have to reduce the strain gauge length to get proper measurement values? To answer this question, a simplification of the analytical model is used by using the Hollermann hardening model with only two parameters. These are the linear factor C, which defines the strength, and the hardening exponent N, which defines the hardening of a material. In these two diagrams, we can see the influence of the linear factor C on the discretization error for both specimen types. Shear strain and N value are constant, while only C changes. It can be seen that C, which represents the strength, has nearly no influence on the discretization error. The error is near constant for each configuration. For this reason, we simplified the model again and assumed that C can be held constant at a value of 200 MPa. In the second step, we investigated the influence of the hardening exponent N on the discretization error. As you see in these two diagrams, the hardening has a major influence on the estimated error. The weaker the hardening, the exponentially higher the discretization error. With smaller strain gauge lengths, the discretization error decreases. These are specimen-specific diagrams for the tensile shear test or the in-plane torsion tests, which only depends on the N-value of the material, which is principally known from the tensile test. But how can we use these diagrams? We can, for example, draw a line of acceptable error and choose proper strain gauge lengths for the DIC setup. For example, a material with an hardening exponent of 0.2 needs a strain gauge length below 0.3 for the shear tests of our investigations to say below 1% discretization error. We can also use the analytical model to find more suitable specimen shapes, which are less sensitive to the discretization error. And this leads us to the second strategy to prevent strain localization. We designed a specimen which shows no strain localization. Conventional grooved in-plane torsion tests show localization at the root of the groove, where stress and strain is maximum, as you can see for the CP1000 on the right side. The new idea is to define the desired stress gradient along the radial position R and construct a grooved in-plane torsion specimen that fulfills the requirements. So the required stress profile should have a wide range of constant shear stress. For this reason, the local thickness is calculated from the equation of shear stress the way that the shear stress is constant. The resulting grooved in-plane torsion specimen shows no localization of strain in the root of the groove. And as a bonus, this new specimen shape is independent of the material properties. To show you at one point of my presentation also results for the third material of our work, the following comparison is done for the high-strength dual-phase steel DP1000 with 1 mm sheath thickness. The hardening of DP1000 is in between the hardening of DC04 and CP1000. As you can see, for the classical round groove, the discretization error is -7.6%. The new specimen shape shows only errors of -0.6% with 0.5 mm gauge length. So this new specimen shape reduces the measurement accuracy significantly. Let me finally summarize the basic take-home messages I tried to submit with my talk. First of all, the exact strain measurement in shear tests is a challenge, since strain localization occurs, which leads to measurement deviations. The measurement deviations can be estimated analytically with our new analytical model. Influences of the strain gauge length, the specimen shape, and the material properties are considered. Weakly hardening materials are more sensitive to strain localization, and to reduce the deviation, the strain gauge lengths in DIC setups should consider the hardening exponent N. Last of all, we presented an in-plane torsion specimen design, which is capable to significantly reduce the strain localization. I hope you enjoyed my talk and thank you for your attention.